excited to be in the house of God?
Yes.
Praise God. We are in for a very good treat this morning.
Amen.
And I'm so excited just to see all of you, the beautiful faces. We are a church that is on the move. If you are here for the first time already, you've been welcomed. But the name of the church is Destiny Empowered Christian Church.
Amen.
We are a movement. Yes. We believe that God has got great things that he has got in store for us.
Amen.
And thank you so much for those that are sacrificing and giving towards our building fund.
Yes.
God is doing just amazing things all over the world. And I thank God, and I thank God for his faithfulness, even as we continue to serve him in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I'm happy to see Ez. I've got a word for you. I sense the Lord. I heard the Lord says there is something that's draining your resources. But the Lord also showed me that you are coming to the end, because with the draining of your resources, sometimes you keep pushing. And sometimes, like, you know, how the waves are tossed to and fro, and we're just being pushed further and further. And I sense that the Lord is actually pushing you closer to him.
Amen.
So I pray that the Lord will continue to reveal himself in a greater way. I'm going to ask everyone to stretch forth your hands towards this beautiful man, his wife, Chevy, and let's pray. Start praying right now. Just pray now in the name of Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord over their lives. Come and pray in church. I can't hear. I hear you whispering. Keep praying. In Jesus' mighty name. Father, thank you. They are on the journey. And I thank you, Father, that God Almighty, you are clearing things. You are clearing things, Lord God Almighty. And I thank you for faithfulness, oh God. Your power and your spirit, oh God, continue to shine forth even over the lives for your glory. I give you praise, Lord Jesus. What an awesome God you are. We glorify your name in this place. In Jesus' name. You believe with me? Shout and say amen.
Amen.
I walked through the door and I was coming in. I was introduced to a young lady. The name was Mwenya. So that's not a prophetic word. It was given to me. Mwenya, let me give you a word. Here's what the Lord is saying to you. I don't know, you're meeting you for the very first time, but Mwenya, the Lord says, I should say to you, I am your cleft on the rock. A lot of things that have tried to move you up and down, try to bring discouragement, disappointment, because where you are in unfamiliar circumstances right now, and it seems to be daunting for you. But the Lord says, I am the Lord your God. And he gave me two words. I will not leave you, and I will not forsake you.
Yes.
Look, you know what those words mean. When God says, I will not leave you, that means physically he will be with you.
Amen.
But when he says, I will not forsake you, that means emotionally I will not leave you.
Right.
Because it is possible for you to be left physically, but emotionally you are stuck.
Amen.
So when God says, I will not leave you, I will not forsake you, that two things.
It means my
presence will be with you.
Amen.
But also emotionally, you will never feel as if I'm distant from you.
Amen.
And that's the word for you. Okay? Just come here, let me pray for you, my girl. Just stand behind it. In Jesus' mighty name. Yeah, start praying. Whenever you pray for somebody, whatever it is that is in yours as well, the Lord fixes it. That's how it works in the things of the Spirit. So, Father, thank you that, God, you are fixing things. You are fixing things back home in Zambia. You are fixing things for here. You are fixing things in Jesus' name. There is a shift in the things of the Spirit of God is beginning to work in your life. She doesn't understand. It's daunting. It's unfamiliar. But whatever it is right now, we remove that cloud over here now in the name of Jesus Christ. And I speak the divine favor of God over our lives in Jesus' mighty name. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Well, I told you that your other family in Japan, they've already given the first 5,000 that goes towards the media sound system. Also gave something close to 2,000 towards the keyboard. Many of you don't know, that keyboard is for Inonge. It's a personal one that she bought with her own money. But she's been using it every time to bring to church. But they've given a key towards the keyboard. That's $2,000. And I want to thank God so much for that in Jesus' mighty name. And guess what? There is more coming. So I want us to get ready, because 70, we are clocking 100 very soon. And once we do that, we want to make sure that we start looking for buildings. For you guys that are out there, we are looking for warehouses. We are looking for empty spaces. Something that is good and that's bougie. You can't have a bougie pastor and you take me in some makeshift type of a building. Come on. Yeah? Somebody shout bougie. That's where we are going. God has got greater things for us. So please, if you see of any property, you know who to call. That's it, brother Trevor right there. Let them see you, Brother Trevor. They don't know who you are. That's him, okay? Trevor or Prince behind the camera there. Let's make sure that we make this thing happen in Jesus' mighty name. I believe that God is going to do great and wonderful things as we serve him in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Sorry? South
Australia.
South Australia.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Okay.
You got behind the sofa. A special meeting.
My wife, too. Oh, thank you,
my special son. I want us to pray for him. Pray that God's grace. I always say to people, the only language that he knows how to communicate effectively is the shofar. Yeah. So bear with him.
Yes.
You know, sometimes it can be too loud for others, but bear with him. Because in heaven, there will be a very big noise taking place. So get used to it while it's just blowing it here. Yeah, Father, we thank you. I pray for Sean. I pray for Donna. It was Donna's 60th birthday yesterday. And I pray that God Almighty, you bless them. If that even is the goal, that God Almighty, you go before him. Because shofars are known to opening up territories and open up avenues. So Lord, we pray that dominions, principalities, and powers will not stand in their way. That your name will be glorified. Take him there and bring him back safe to us, to your glory. In Jesus' mighty name. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Bless you. You are ready for the word? Homebrew is coming up this morning. And I thank God so much for your heart. Since she was introduced to the spiritual family, and we've just grown to love. I love the maturity. I love the wisdom that comes out through her. And I'm going to ask right now for us to give God a big hand of praise as we welcome right now Sister Leslie to come and give us the word of God in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, give a big hand. Praise God. Come on, you can do better than that. Come on. Praise God. We celebrate gifts in this church. And part of the idea of the apostolic house, it is because we are not just raising people-driven or pastor-driven churches. Because an apostle raises sons and daughters. And that's what we are all about. So we thank God so much. You receive the word of the Lord. And I pray that God will bless your life today in Jesus' name. Nick, thank you once again for being here today. And together with your friend, I pray that the Lord is going to bless us, even to serve God together in Jesus' name. Love you, brother. God bless you.
Thank you. Wow, what a welcome. I feel like I'm a superstar. Thank you, Pastor Josh, for that warm welcome. Thank you, everybody, for your encouragement. Praise the Lord. I was really impressed by moved by some of the songs that we sang today in praise to God. It really helps us when we get up here to speak and to calm our nerves and to make sure that, because, you know, we write everything down because we want to make sure that we say all the right things and we don't say words back to front. So thank you, Pastor Josh. Thank you very much. Now, a few Sundays ago, I was sitting down the back and I had trouble seeing the front. And Anonge was speaking, and it was her turn to give the sermon. And I'm sitting down there, and I was thinking about what Pastor Josh, the invitation that Pastor Josh sent to me about speaking today. And I felt moved by the Lord to move up closer so that I'm not sort of looking like this whenever Anonge moves around, that I've got a clear vision of her. And in my mind, I'm sort of contemplating what I'm going to say because I couldn't possibly get up here and deliver the message because I actually thought Pastor Josh wanted me to give a testimony before the service. And he said, no, I'm asking you, I'm inviting you to give the message. So I'm thinking, you know, look, I didn't study theology. I'm not a pastor. I've never given a sermon before. And that other people have been here a lot longer than I have. And I thought, well, you know, they have more right to stand up here. I'm not worthy to give God's message. And God bless Anonge. Anonge's talk was about being obedient. It was about not being a right to be up here, but an anointing from God. It's a privilege and an honour to speak up the front. And that we are always putting up the barriers about why we can't do certain things and why we can't go in certain ways. And Anonge spoke more about the benefits of speaking. And already this morning I was thinking about the benefits of all the reading I've been doing over the last few years. The message I wanted to bring that I felt moved by God to bring you is prayer. because I've always been praying. I thought, Lord, I want to be a prayer warrior. And I've been reading lots of books and watching lots of sermons from different pastors from overseas and doing some courses online for the last few years. So I mentioned this invitation to my sister, and because we always pray together, and she lives in Queensland, and we're the only two in our family. I'm the eldest of nine, so we are the only two who are following God's word. And she said, "Well, sis," she was really happy. She was clapping. She says, "Well, sis, it's about time you stepped out of your boat." And I thought, well, okay, there you go. So thanks to Pastor, he's gently pushing me a little bit and giving me that courage to step out of the boat. Yes. So, look, I just wanted to read a story first. I bought a book for a friend of mine who attends the Victory Life Church, and she's a bit of a cat lover. So I bought her a book. And while I was sitting and having a cup of coffee, I flicked through the book and I spotted something. And, of course, then she turns up and I said, "I've just bought you a book and I'm reading something out of it I want to use before I give it to you." And it's called The Vanishing Visitor. It's preceded by Revelations 3:20. "And behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come to him and eat with him and he with me." The tapping on the window increased. Cynthia walked to the cupboard, poured out some cat food and fluffed up her comforter. Within minutes, Rama the cat entered her apartment via the deck door. He gobbled up the cat food, fluffed up his tail and passed out in the middle of the bed, drifting into a peaceful afternoon nap. There was one little problem with this afternoon's visitor and the siesta. It wasn't Rama's home. So you might be tempted to label Rama as an interloper. But he was warmly welcomed, and in fact, everyone in the New York neighbourhood loved this cat. And although he was well cared for his family, Rama was a bit of a wanderer. Rama would eagerly eat your food and take respite on your freshly washed sheets and drop cat's hair everywhere on the floor before heading back home. His visits were short and sweet, a quick hello before disappearing over the window ledge. When I think about Rama's rather self-centred visit, I wonder if we do the same to God. Are we guilty of coming to him only when we need something? Are we guilty of coming... Perhaps we can come into God's presence just long enough to grab a snack, find relief from life's storms. We ask for 30-second answers to our deepest prayers and our deepest troubles. We enter his presence in desperation, but we aren't willing to stay long. We are in and out of his heavenly home without even hanging up our coat in the closet. Excuse me. And then she goes on to write, "Temporary visits with God are like visiting a vending machine. We turn to one when we want something, like a tasty candy bar. We quickly move on to the next desire once the candy is in hand. That approach doesn't work with God. He's eternal, not temporary. Yes. He wants long-term visits. He wants long-term visits when we wrestle with the biblical principles and promises and absorb his greatest wisdom. If we're guilty of short visits with God, we need to pray for the desire to stay longer. We're never interlopers before our Saviour. God's door is always open." So I just wanted to share that story with you. I thought that was a beautiful story. And, of course, I love cats too, but I'm more of a dog person. So I'd just like to pray. Thank you, Lord. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for all who stood up here before me to deliver your word. I thank you for the message of encouragement. I thank you for their strength, Father God, for the message of deliverance. And Father God, we at Destiny, we do not wish to be interlopers. We do not wish to just come to you during the stormy moments of our lives, Lord. We want to come to you in the good times, Lord, to celebrate, Lord, to celebrate when you deliver us, Lord, out of those terrible times that we go through in our lives, Heavenly Father, when you build us up, Lord God. Lord, we want to come to you to learn to lean on you and to grow through your grace and through your love. We seek a strong and enduring relationship with you, Lord, through your word and through your message, Lord, so that we may be worthy ambassadors for you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'd just like to have a talk to you about three things that's been on my heart over the last few months. why we need to pray, when we need to pray, and how we need to pray. Yeah? So pray the word. What does pray mean? Anyone ever look up the definition of the word pray? Pray to God. Okay. Address a prayer to God, a devout petition to God. And the Hebrew translation of prayer is a procession of a process of accounting and contemplation. So when we pray, we are engaging in spiritual communion with God. We are before the throne of God. That's our object of worship. Making supplication, thanksgiving, we make confession, and we are connecting with God. Amen. We ask God for salvation, for deliverance. We ask Him for forgiveness and for protection. And we ask Him for our daily needs and our provisions. So why do we pray to God? Why do we need to pray? The first point is that we pray for a personal relationship with God. Amen. Yeah? He wants to communicate with us and He will listen. God will answer our prayers in His time and in His way for His purpose, blessing us and our families as part of His answering and giving. 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 to 2 says, "First of all, then, I urge that entreaties and prayer and petitions and thanksgiving be made on behalf of all men, for kings and all who are in authority, so that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity." So prayer invites peace in our lives. And, you know, we all still have our trials and tribulations. You know, we will never be without any challenges in our lives because we're Christians. We don't have life easy, do we? In fact, sometimes it can be very hard, yeah? And so it's important that we stay with God. We maintain, we increase, we improve our prayer life. God promises to take care of us. God, our living Father in heaven, God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, He guides us and teaches us in order for us to grow in our faith.
Amen.
Yeah?
Amen.
And God will still carry us through when we stumble and fall. Yeah. I can tell you, over the years, I've stumbled many a times, living between Queensland and New South Wales and now Western Australia. If we do not pray to our living Father in heaven on a regular basis, and I'm hoping that everyone will praise every day, at least once a day, then how can we expect to have a loving relationship with Him? Yeah? I can't imagine leaving the house without praying. I can't imagine going to bed without praying. I can't imagine ringing my first client who's just come through a terrible trauma of a suicide of a loved one without praying. Yeah? Okay. Thank goodness I had thought to number the pages. I'd be really lost. I'd have to sing and dance to make up.
Holy Spirit in the wind.
That's it. That's it. Thank you, Brother Sean. So how can we expect to have a loving relationship with Him if we don't pray on a regular basis? So God will help us to learn. Our prayer will help us to learn more about God. Incorporating scriptures in our prayers will also help us to learn and improve our prayer vernacular. And I was talking to someone this morning. We were saying sometimes you don't have to include the scriptures in our prayers, but sometimes if you're praying for something really specific, it's my belief that you find a scripture, because then that helps you to focus on God's answers as well, and to focus on God as God is going to lead you through whatever you're going through. So, and you know, many times we all pray without scriptures. You know, and when I write my prayers, I write them with scriptures because that helps me. So we can benefit by keeping a journal and writing the prayers. And I used to write the prayers and then go away and do my business, and I'll pick up the journal and I'll come back and I'll have a little flick through, and I thought, oh yes, I forgot about that. I remember God actually answered that prayer and I didn't even say thank you. And so I've taught myself to save a bit of space after the prayer instead of going straight into the next one. And I go back with a different coloured pen and I write a thank you prayer to God. And it doesn't have to be long, sometimes I squeeze it in, you know, just write about two within the lines, two lines within one, and say thank you, God. And you know, it's really good to look back and to see where God has brought you.
Yes.
And you're sitting there and you're thinking, wow, did I really go through that?
Wow.
Was I really going through that time? Look how God has brought me through. Praise the Lord. So prayer is powerful. and especially when it's based upon God's words, hence the importance of incorporating scriptures in our prayers. And we had, hopefully someone will be able, I won't mention anyone's name and sort of embarrass them, but they're sitting down the back down there in the corner. talking about the answer that God has given for her mum for surgery, hopefully for surgery coming soon rather than next year. And that's God answering her prayer and answering the prayer of the women's group who are praying for her. It's very, very powerful. James 4:8 says, "Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. He will always stay with us and stay with you." The second point why prayer is important. Prayer will bring us closer to God and help us to gain an understanding of God's loving nature. 1 John 4:8 simply says, "God is love." The scripture says, "He who loves not knows not God, for God is love." So, yeah. So Father God, we are destined... being vigilant in our praying will help us to grow closer to God's love. Luke 10:27, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your strength." As we learn to understand God, we learn to understand his intent for us, his destiny, his will. We will see what God has ordained for us to do and where he wants us to be. God will open doors that he wants us to go through, and he will close doors that he doesn't want us to go back through, doesn't want us to regress. Amen. We don't want to go back to the old ways. We want to stay with the new. Amen. Well, certainly I don't, not what I've come through. Thank you, Lord. Amen. So understanding God and his loving nature will help us to be wiser and therefore stronger members of the body of Christ. Amen. So here's a promise from God in Proverbs 2, verses 6 to 11. Verse 6, "For the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh understanding." Verse 7, "He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly." Verse 8, "He keepeth the path of judgment and preserve the ways of his saints." 9, then thou shalt understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. Verse 10, "When wisdom entereth into thine heart, and knowledge is pleasant, unto thy soul." And verse 11, "Discretion shall preserve thee, and understanding will keep thee." Wow. The third reason why it's important for us to pray is that we are looking for answers. We are looking for answers. So we need to also, you know, when we're asking God and praying to God for our needs, we also need to listen to God and meditate without saying anything sometimes, or praying in the Spirit, because we need to keep our ears, our spiritual ears open. So when God answers our prayers, that we will pick it up. Amen. Yeah, we don't have to go back and write between two lines between one in our prayer journals. God gives us help to better understand our purpose in life. He will help us understand why we are here and what we do to live in this life and in the life with him, in the life hereafter. When we pray to God, he will teach us and guide us, and he will strengthen us to keep our path to heaven. 1 John 4, verses 14 and 15. "And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we are asking anything of his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have petition that we desired of him." Amen. Yeah? So true believing gives us proper confidence, which is proper assurance, and we should pray for the provision and expressed and implied, "If it will be your will, God." Amen. Amen. There are lots of things we want and lots of things we need, and God sees our needs. Yeah? Yep. And God will sometimes give us our wants if they are within his will. Yeah? Right. Amen. Yes. 1 Peter 3:12 says, "For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers." So God is really watching over us all the time. He's listening to us, and he's seeing how we are trusting in him. And Peter assures us that God is hearing our prayers. Amen. The fourth reason for why is direction. Prayer will help us to find direction in our lives and open our spiritual eyes to see those directions that God has already mapped out for us, even before we were born. Yeah? So when seeking directions from God, Jeremiah expressed his doubts in doing what God was asking of him because he was too young. He considered himself too young and he couldn't possibly go and give God's message. God said to him in Jeremiah 1:5, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee. And I ordained thee to be a prophet unto the nations." Yeah? So when we remember these words of God to Jeremiah, we can take hold of those mighty words and apply them to ourselves and know that God has this. God has us. Amen. And Anne said to me this morning, "God has this. God has you." Yes, amen. We are in his hands, and that's the best place to be. I don't want to be anywhere else but in God's hands and in this church. In God's hand in this church. I thought I better add that in. So our job here as believers is to exercise and demonstrate with genuineness our faith and pray to God. And we pray in earnest, we pray for our needs, and we place our lives in his hands. Amen. Psalm 38:2, "I will instruct and teach you in the way that you should go, and I will guide you with my eye." Yes. So in summary, the need to pray, that God wants us to pray regularly in order to have a personal relationship with him. Yeah. We pray to gain an understanding of God's loving nature. And God hears and answers our prayers, and we pray in order for God to give us blessings. Yeah? Thank you. Thank you, Nongay. That's great. Yeah, when we pray. Nongay, could I have Matthew 6, verse 5, please? Sorry, I should have mentioned this to you earlier. So could we just read this Matthew's 6 verse 5? Yes. Yes. Can we read this together, please? Yeah. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for thy love to pray in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. And assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. So, for me, when I was reading this, I went back to it and that when you pray, right? When you pray, the necessity of prayer. Jesus didn't say, if you feel like praying, or maybe you want to think about praying. He didn't say, I would like you to pray, okay? He's actually making a statement. When you pray, so he's telling us that we will pray. He's expecting us to pray, yeah? How can we grow without praying to God? Yeah? And if you read the next verse, verse 6. Again. And when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in heaven, and your Father who sees in secret openly. Thank you. So when you pray, when you pray, so, and not to use vain repetitions as the heathens do, praying the same verse and phrase over and over and over again. And then on verse 8 it goes on to say, "But you therefore like unto them, for your Father, our Heavenly Father, knows what things you need of before you ask of him." Hallelujah. After all, he's the all-powerful, all-knowing God, yeah? He knows all of our needs. He knows all things because, after all, he created us. He knows all the past, all the present, and everyone's future because he made us. So should we pray to God in a particular order? And I think yes and no. I think sometimes when we first learn to pray, we have an order to help us so that we know how to pray. And if we are praying in the right way and being genuine in our prayer to God, he will then take over and we will be praying the way he wants us to pray. So when we pray, we praise and glorify God. When we pray, we give thanks. And then we seek forgiveness of our sins, because we want to stand before God with a clean heart. We want to make petition and pray for others with a clean heart. Yeah? Amen. And of course, we want to pray for ourselves. And there's some, I was listening to Dr. Kevin Zardai, and he says that he prays for everybody else. He never asks God for anything for him, because he believes if he's doing God's will and praying for others and helping others, that that God will automatically give, and it God does, he says, automatically gives him what he needs, because he's looking after the rest of the body of Christ. Yeah. And then, of course, when we come to the end of the prayer, we always give thanks to our Father in heaven. And in Jesus' name we say, Amen. Yeah. So the first one, when we pray, praise and glorify God, our Creator, our living God in heaven. So Matthew 6 goes on to say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So we bless the holy name of God. We bless the Creator of our life. Psalm 101 says 3, Bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Every time I read that, I want to break out in song. It's a beautiful song. We give thanksgiving. So we thank God for our lives, for what we have. We thank him for what we've been through, where we've been and where we've come. We thank him for our family, our friends. We thank him for our church and our pastors and our leaders in our church. We thank him because we have jobs. We have a home. Yeah? That doesn't mean to say that we're any better than anybody else, but God has given us that, and we need to be grateful and thankful for what he's done. He's carried us through our experience and through our darkest moments. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 to 18 says, Rejoice always, pray continually, and give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Yeah. Most of all, we thank God because he sent his only son for us, to die for us, to give us a new testament to live under. When I read through the Old Testament, I don't know how we would survive. Knowing what we know in this day and age, how would we survive living under the Old Testament? The third point about seeking forgiveness, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We claim that forgiveness by the blood of the cross, and we thank Jesus for his ultimate love and action. We had a sermon by the Professor Blessing quite a few months ago, and he said the cross is actually Jesus, the God's love in action, and it really, really hit home. And I thought, wow, that was just powerful. We can declare 1 John 1:7, if I walk in the light as he is in the light, and we have fellowship with one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses me from all sins. That's a claim that we have. And if any of you have received a book from Pastor called Key Kingdom Living, that's on page 97. I know that because I say it almost every other night. It's there, and I need it. I need to pray, and I need to claim the blood of Jesus over my life and over my sins. So why do we need to seek forgiveness? Naturally, we want to be in God's presence. We want to be with a clean heart and a clean slate. We don't want to be hypocrites, yeah? Wouldn't it be terrible if we had all this sin behind us, what we did last night, what we did yesterday, and we're not repenting, and yet we expect to stand before the throne and speak to God and ask God to give us something or to save our son or our daughter. So we are demonstrating our belief in the cross of Jesus, yeah, when we seek forgiveness. We accept that he did this to save us from sin and from the law of sin and death. And through his blood, we have victory over the sin. And hopefully that through his blood, we continue to learn from our mistakes and not make the same mistakes over and over and over again. And I had that issue at one stage last year, and I can hear God saying, oh, for goodness sake, you know, why don't you just move on? You know, you're confessing the same sin. I heard it yesterday. I heard it the day before. I heard it last week. You know? When are you going to get over it? When are you going to get over it? Number four. Netflix. Thank goodness I don't have Netflix anymore. I've gotten over it. Too much time. Sorry, Lord, I'm spending too much time watching this when I should be doing something more meaningful. Number four, praying for the needs of others. Yep. We also pray for our family and our friends, our pastors, our church leaders, at least I hope you do, our spiritual family and all their families here, because everyone is going through something. We need to always hold our families up in prayer. We don't know what's going on. Everyone comes here, everyone looks beautiful, everyone's happy and smiling, you know, and you don't know what's going on, you know, because we believe that we want to leave everything behind and come here, because we come here to be fulfilled. And then we have prayer later after the service. So and sometimes we forget, but you know, we come in with what's on our mind, and we forget what other people are going through. You know, and we don't necessarily have to know the business. We don't have to know what's going on. We just need to know that everyone in here is experiencing something, yeah, and that we are all in need of God, and we are all in need of prayer, yeah. So God knows. He knows everything. So all sincere prayer and supplication for others around us are heard by God, because Jesus said in Matthew 18:20, "For where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them." Yeah. So this is why Destiny Empowered Christian Church has a number of prayer connect groups.
Yes.
Yeah. So we have groups for men and women and for young people, and we have them in their respective ages. So if you are not on a prayer connect group, ladies, talk to Anne
and Sue.
Yes. Yeah. And because we have leaders for different age groups, and we have cards, and Ongo very kindly made us up little cards to give out to everybody within our age group. And I'll keep on looking, because I'm the 50 and over, and I'm looking at, is that person over 50? Maybe I better not. I better find out another way first, another subtle way. So if you're a lady 50 and over, I'm the person to come and collect my card. Thanks, Aileen. And for the men folk, it's Brad, and is it Pastor Prince or just Brad for the men, the prayer connect for men? Pastor Prince. So there you have it. Okay. You know who to go to now. So I expect everyone after service will be rushing to everybody. Pray for self. When we pray for ourselves, you know, the devil is a liar. He's a thief and a liar. Yeah. He will constantly come into our lives and attempt to destroy us. So we must always be vigilant in our prayers to God. We must always be watchful. And he will kill your joy, I tell you. We have to be so in tune with God, with our Christian walk, and covering ourselves all the time, because he will take away our joy. He will take our families with us. So constantly praying the precious blood of Jesus over our lives, over our family, our friends, our colleagues. And I pray the blood of Jesus over all my clients that I have, and our pastors. All important for us. And ensure that we hold, you know, we all hold this wonderful gift, the armour of God that we have in the Bible, in Ephesians.
Yes.
And I read from Ephesians 10, I read it as a prayer down to part of 20. And the spiritual armour of God is one of the best protections that we have. It's right there in the Bible. Turn it into a prayer. And when I start at verse 10, it says, finally, brethren, I just say, finally, I, Leslie, I am can be strong in you, Lord, in the power of your might.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's one of my protection prayers. So if you're feeling low and in despair, Psalm 91 is also a good prayer to go to, because sometimes you're going through such a hard time. You might be having a hard time with family or at work, and you go home and you know that you should be praying to God to hand it over to him, but you can't. You're so distressed about something. That and you might even be very angry about how you've been treated at work, if you've been, you know, subjected to racism or exclusion or bullying, which seems to be a big thing in some of our, thank goodness, thank the Lord, it's not in our work, but yes, it's really important. So I would urge you just to meditate on Psalm 91, or find, you know, over time, find your favorite verse, the verse that speaks to you, the chapter in the book that speaks to you. And then we finish with praise and thanksgiving, because we thank God for everything. We give him the power and the glory forever and ever. Yep. Amen.
Amen.
Right. Okay. So in summary, we pray, while we pray, to give praise to God. We thank him, we seek forgiveness, and we pray for others when we pray to God. Now I'm just going to touch on the last subject on how we pray. And I'm going to invite my very dear friend, Anne, to come and join me. If you will indulge me, is that okay? Sure. We're going to do a little bit of a skit.
Are you going to be walking along?
Yes. Rightio, so we are going to pretend that we've been invited to have an audience with King Charles, because he's coming to Perth, make believe he's coming to Perth. And guess what? I've got an invitation to go to see King Charles.
No.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Can you be my plus one?
I can.
Oh, great, great.
It's like a crowd, you and me by ourselves.
Absolutely. Yeah. Let's do it.
That sounds exciting.
Absolutely. I should have asked for another mic. Can you hear?
No. Can you hear me?
I'm on it.
Just got a voice.
Thank you, Georgie.
Thank you, Georgie.
So have you done this before?
No, actually I haven't. No.
So what's it look like for you going to see the king? So what's that going to be like for us?
Oh, I don't know, actually. I think we better do some research and find out how we're supposed to behave.
Yes.
What to say.
And how do you think we should dress? Do you think we should just go in thongs and sandals and a thongs and a sarong? You know, because, you know, it's just King Charles, really, isn't it?
It's just
you reckon my little old Aussie thongs and... Yeah. I know thongs mean something else in other countries, so I've got to be careful what I say. Thongs for my feet. And just a sarong, do you reckon that'd be okay if I just rock up looking like that?
Well, actually, I just turned the letter over and it says formal.
Oh.
Formal
so
wear.
So good thongs then.
Thongs with diamantes. So formal for ladies.
Yeah.
You're formal for ladies and black tie for men. So,
okay.
I don't know.
So what do you think we should do? Like when we're sort of coming towards the king, we meet together, we're walking down towards the king.
Yeah.
What do you think we should do? Do you think we should just look him in the eye? Charles, what do you think we should do?
Hello, Charlie.
No. Hey, mate. what do you think?
Yes.
So, how should we approach him, do you think?
Well, I think we should be well dressed.
Yes.
Obviously,
okay.
we'll take. Well, they said that for a reason, so I guess we have to.
No,
I don't think so. No.
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I think we need to, be genuine. You know, we wouldn't want to walk down and go, oh, hello, Charlie, how are you?
Yeah. Be respectful.
Respectful,
I think so. I think that's a good idea. Well, I'm really looking forward to that.
Great.
So I think we should get matching outfits.
Yes.
Matching.
Yes.
A bit of makeup and
absolutely.
Rouge, a bit of
absolutely.
Lips on.
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Can't wait.
Can't wait. Thank you. Oh, thank you, Anne, for being a good sport. Thanks. Thanks a lot. So you're probably thinking now, what's that got to do with prayer? Yeah? It's got a lot to do with prayer. Yep. So if we go before the king of the land or a dignitary and we dress up, now we wouldn't just get out of bed and just tussle our bed hair. I was trying to find a photo of me with bed hair when I had my hair longer. We wouldn't just go along in our PJs or our, you know, tracky dacks or anything like that. We would actually make an effort to present ourselves in an appropriate manner.
That's right.
So, of course, we wouldn't do that. So it's important for us to remember that when we pray, where are we going when we pray? If you sit, if you stand, if you kneel, we are going before the throne of God.
Come on.
Amen?
Come on.
Yes. So we need to be presentable. Not at all times, and I'll talk about that in a minute, but we need to be presentable. Yeah? We are standing before the King. We are standing before the Creator. Yeah? We need to respect His presence. We need to respect His grace and His merciful ways. His willingness to continue to forgive us on a regular basis. Yeah? Forgive our transgressors. If you don't believe me, 2 Timothy 2:15 says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who does not need to be ashamed or who handles the the word of truth, correctly handles the word of truth. Yeah. So one of the courses that I was doing was this part about how to pray, and this is one of the ones that stood out in my mind that I remembered. And it so happens that I couldn't sleep, and so it was summer. It was terribly hot, and I was renting a little place somewhere in Maylands, and I just couldn't sleep. So I got up and I thought, well, I'll do another module of this course. And I'm sitting there and I had collarless, sleeveless T-shirt on and trying to get cool. And this subject came up before, that when we throne of God, we need to represent ourselves as best as possible because we are standing before the King, the Creator. And so I pull the sheet up over... And I'm sitting there, I'm putting the sheet around me and I'm wrapping it around me like a sarong around me, thinking, oh, okay. And then I was doing the course a little bit later, and then I thought, I better go out and pray. And so I went and changed. I put a T-shirt over my clothes because I was feeling like I'm not worthy to stand before the throne of God. So, of course, there are exceptions to the rule. You know, if your partner's having a bad dream, having a nightmare, or your child next door is screaming in the middle of the night... And you go to see them and you think, okay, it's a bad dream, I need to pray for you, but I'll wait a minute, child, I've got to run and get myself dressed first. I'll go and comb my hair and then I'll come back and then I'll pray for you. Well, you know, we don't have to take that suggestion to the extreme, because God understands your priorities. He knows your priorities. He knows every second of every day of what you need to do for yourself and your family and for your job. Yeah? The second point I want to talk about in how to pray is the vernacular, the words that we use. You ever heard, listen to other people praying? Pastor Josh and Anonga, Pastor Shirley, Pastor Prince, and you think, wow, that's just awesome how they just string those words together. And Jenny gets up, just was put on the spot and pray for the offering. Isn't that just amazing? I want to pray like that. I want to be able to use words like that. I want that kind of vernacular. Well, my friends, be assured that the special gift that God has given each and every one of us. Yeah. Yeah? And it's up to us to realise that gift through our prayer and through our walk with God. So be assured that God wants to hear from you.
Come on.
Yeah? He wants to hear your words. He wants to hear what you have to say. He wants your style of prayer. I mean, God knows what you have to say, but he wants you. He wants you to open your mouth and speak to him in your words, your thoughts, and he wants to hear your desires. So God has given us a special gift. We all have the special gift. We have our own way of serving him. Yeah? Everyone's different. But no one is no better than anybody else, because we're all different. That's the way God made us, and that's the gift that he has given us. His will for us in our lives and through prayer. So we pray to him, we worship him, and God will reveal his will. And then one day, after God teaches you and guides you through your prayer life, someone will hear you praying and they'll be saying, wow, I want to learn to pray like her, or I want to learn to pray like him. I want to be a strong person of God to pray like that. Sorry? Vernacular, language, which word? The words. What words would you use to pray to God? Yes. Your own words. Yep. Yeah. Your own words. Yep. And if you're stuck, there's always the Bible. There's beautiful verses in the Bible. Psalms and Proverbs is just awesome to go through when you're stuck. So he will teach us how he wants us to pray to him. How he wants us to communicate with him. And one day, as I said, someone will be saying the same thing about you. And you know, Matthew 6 verses 9 to 13 is the Lord's Prayer that we didn't go on to read when we had the scriptures up earlier. That's the best model of prayer that we have. Yeah. There's always that one. And the third and last point about how to pray is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Being filled with the Holy Spirit and praying in tongues, the language of the Holy Spirit. Yeah. So why do we need to pray in tongues? Why do we need to utter words that we don't understand? The first one, God's word in the Bible teaches us that when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, we speak with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives us utterance. Speaking in tongues is an initial evidence or a sign of baptism of the Holy Spirit. Yeah? Acts 2, chapter 2, verse 4, and they were filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues, and the Spirit gave them utterance. So in his letter, Paul encouraged the Corinthians to speak, to continue to practice the speaking in other tongues in their worship of God and in their individual prayer life, to build up their lives and their prayer life, and to strengthen their connection with God. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 14 says, "For when I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prayeth." Yeah.
Yes.
God is spirit.
Yep.
So when we pray in tongues, our spirit is in direct contact with God.
Yes.
For God is spirit.
Amen.
Paul reminds us that when we speak in tongues, we are talking to him by divine natural means. The third point, when we speak in tongues, we remain aware of God's holy indwelling presence.
Yes.
And if we pray in tongues every day, that's bound to affect the way we live, the way we walk, the way we think, the way we go about our daily lives.
Absolutely.
Amen?
Absolutely.
Amen. The fourth one is that when we pray, when we pray, we mostly know how to pray, but not always what to pray.
Yes.
Yeah. But what does God want us to pray about? We know what we want to pray about, but what does God want us to pray about? Yeah? And how does he want us to pray? So praying in tongues will ensure that our prayers are not selfish and that we are not praying with our own mind, our own natural, our thinking, the way we think, because we tend to be overthinking, because it may be unscriptural and selfish. So Romans 8:26, for we know not when we should pray as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings and which cannot be uttered. Yeah, so we're allowing the Holy Spirit to come into our lives and into our prayer life. Yeah. Number five, as believers in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we pray in tongues to learn to trust God, to build up our faith. Jude 1, chapter 1, the only chapter, verse 20. "But ye beloved, building up yourselves in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost."
Yeah, so good.
And the next chapter goes on about maintaining or being in the circle of love, staying in the circle of love and staying in God's love. And there's a really beautiful sermon online called The Circle of Love. It's absolutely in the praying circle. It's an absolutely beautiful sermon by an American pastor. Point six, the second last point. The Holy Spirit provides us with a way to pray about things that we might not think about. Or we might not even be aware of the needs of others.
True.
Or situations where prayer of believers is required. But the Holy Spirit knows all things. The Holy Spirit everywhere can pray for us things about which we know nothing about and about our natural mind. Our nature mind doesn't know anything about. James 3:8 says, "But the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil full of deadly poison." So praying in tongues will help us to learn to control our tongue as well. Yeah? If we can learn to yield our tongue, we will be praying and taking a big step in yielding all members of our body of Christ. Because speaking in tongues is evidence that we are filled with the Holy Spirit. Such a wonderful gift that God has blessed us with to edify us and to refresh us throughout our lives in this life and to refresh our life on earth. So I've got the summary up of that slide. Anyway, in summary, we say we present ourselves, praying as we ought to pray, we present ourselves appropriately to God when we enter his throne room. We learn how to use God's words and language and pray. If anything can go wrong, it will. And it will go wrong in a very big way. So that's when we need to, you know, when we're feeling flat, we need to make sure that our prayer life is really, you know, we're standing on solid grounds when we stand on God, you know, stand before the throne of God. And we don't need to feel unworthy when we stand before the throne of God. So maybe we need to, you know, look at how our lives are going and maybe develop ourselves a prayer kit that may consist of a journal and another little book to read, a book of verses, you know, something that's, or someone who's written a book. One of the great books I've read is Being a Prayer Warrior. It's an awesome book. I'll find out the author, because I can't remember for the moment, because I've got about four books about prayer sitting around my bed, so I get a bit confused. But which author am I reading now? So I encourage you to find these verses and these books in the Bible that you will be drawn to. There's much more to focus on, you know, when we come to prayer. I mean, I haven't even talked about the times that Jesus prayed, when he prayed, why he prayed. There's about 23 verses in the Bible that describes when and how Jesus prayed, definitely before each of the miracles. Yeah. I haven't even talked about how David prayed, the prayers that he was going through. If you read some of his words in the book of Psalms, some of his books in there, some of the Psalms, he was going through a lot through battle, just his own personal life as well as being the king of the land at the time. I haven't even talked about or even touched on how Moses, Joshua or Joseph, many other prophets, how they took their directions from God. And they prayed daily. They were in daily communication with God. They didn't make a move unless God said, you do, you go. You do it this way and you do it that way. I haven't even talked about how singing and dancing can be used. Singing and dancing for the Lord can be used in our praise and worship. You know, isn't it a wonderful feeling we come in here in the morning and we start off with praise and worship songs to God? It's a wonderful feeling. It's really uplifting, isn't it? And if we feel like that, how must God feel when we're praising his holy name? Yeah? So look, I'd just like to finish off with a prayer, a poem that was adapted from Sandra Goodwin's poem. And it's called Travel on My Knees. Last night I took a journey to Israel across the seas. I did not go by boat, I travelled on my knees. I saw so many people there with scars and wounds within. But God told me I should go. There was oil to pour from him. I replied, Lord, I cannot go and work with such as these. He quickly answered, yes, you can by travelling on your knees. He said, you pray and I will meet their needs. You call and I will hear. Be concerned about the fate of those both far and near. And I tried it. I knelt in prayer. I gave up some hours of ease. I felt the Lord right by my side while travelling on my knees. As I prayed on and I saw them helped and the badly wounded healed, I saw God work his strength while labouring on the field. I said, yes, Lord, I have a job, my desire, thy will to please. I can go and heed thy call by travelling on my knees. Amen. Thank you.
Well done, come on, God. Well done. Well done. Come on, give God a big hand of praise. I can't overemphasize for you and I how important it's the only key that brings you here and closer to God Almighty. Nothing else. And I want us to continue to employ this element of communicating with God through prayer. Sister Leslie, you do not realize how relevant your talk was this morning. Next week, the 28th of May, it falls into what they call the Global Day of Prayer. And it's happening in Willerton. You know, I thought actually you guys were going to announce that. That happens number 15 Augusta, is it?
Yes, 15 Augusta in Willerton.
I'm going to encourage you to go there. That's where all different churches, the whole city of Perth comes together. We are praying. Because many of you know that there is nothing that will change this city apart from prayer.
Absolutely.
Nothing will change in your family apart from prayer. In fact, the highest level of walking with God, it is when you know how to talk to God for yourself.
Come on.
The best level is like me when I want something from Shelley. And I ask my brother Edward, can you tell Shelley that please I need some money? Edward, please can you tell Shelley, I just want to know what shirt should I put on? Edward, please can you tell Shelley if she can pick up the kids? Shelley is wondering, what's your problem? You are my husband. Why are you not talking to me? Why are you going through somebody else? But we do that all the time. We come to church. It's good for us to be prayed for. But always remember, the highest level of walking with God, God wants to hear from you. And you know, I think you mentioned something very, very powerful. That it doesn't have to be as polished as Ian's prayers. It doesn't have to be as polished as Elizabethan English, like Inonga's English. You go to God with your own, in your own way. God understands that. Actually, some of the things that I've enjoyed when I go to places where they are gangsters and they go before God and you see them and the way they pray that, you know, big man, you know, I want you in my life and I want to touch my family. And I'm thinking, gee gosh, because it's the lingo that they are used to. So you can go to God in your own way and God understands that. So I want to encourage you that I believe in these times we're living in, connect back with God. And I want to end by saying this. 1942, a professor took his students to Epworth in England, an old house. But this place is like a rectory, and that's where John Wesley, the reformer, used to stay. All these rooms in there, there's a library of the books that he used to read. They've managed to preserve much of that stuff. So you can imagine that on the Bible school students, on their field trip, they are taken by the professor. And when they arrive there, you know students starting to be pastors and preachers. They rushed into the house and everyone else, others were running to the chair, which John Wesley used to sit in because they think that's where anointing is, you know. And they said, oh, this is the chair that he used to stay in. And this is the cup that he used to use when he was alive. And this is the plate he used to eat from. And they're all running for all these things because they wanted to see, I want the anointing that was upon John Wesley to be upon my life. Until the professor took them to the bedroom that he used to sleep in. And when I arrived there, they find out that there are, it's an old carpet, very old carpet, no tattered and then, but there's something there that touches the students when the professor says to them, you see the two marks that are there on that carpet there? That's where daily John Wesley used to go and kneel down there. There are patches that are there to them that are patches of his knees where he used to be there daily in prayer. And his prayer was simple. His prayer was direct, and his prayer was simply was, Lord, do it again. Bring revival. What you did in the first century, do it again. So the students are all mesmerized, but of course, as you know, everyone was after the books that he used to read. Others are after, but the way he used to sit on eating and the plate that he used to use. And the field trip got finished, and everybody went back to the student. And that student, they looked for him everywhere. They could not find him. They went to the patio, went to the veranda. They looked for him everywhere. In the bathroom, they went even in the pantry, back to the library. They couldn't find him. They're asking, where is this student? The student had slipped in back into the bedroom where they were being told about where he used to pray. And the student knelt down exactly on those patches and is kneeling down there. And the professor comes now hurriedly looking for him, that we are looking for you. The bus is about to go. And he just went and tapped on his shoulders. And he says, son, it's time. But before he said, hearing the student saying the same prayers, Lord, what you did in John Wesley's time, Do it again. Went back to the bus. And I know that God did it again through Billy Graham. There is power in prayer. We complain a lot, we pray less. We worry a lot, we pray less. But I pray that out of this today, may we be the ones that are going to say before God, Lord, do it again in our city. Do it again in Australia. May God, may you bring true revival that will change lives. And I believe God can do that. So Sister Leslie, thank you so much for allowing God to use you today. I say to you, there are two things that are major happening this year. It is the Global Day of Prayer happening next week. It is the World Prayer Assembly that has been brought to Perth this time around in October.
Yes, 3rd to 6th October.
From the 3rd to the 6th of October. Please, if you can, or like you to go there. I think it's happening where? It's in, what venue?
Oh, that's in Perth, Entertainment Centre.
Let's come. It's all, once again, churches and ministries coming together. Actually, the people from Japan, the Bible school that I run, some of them are coming in, so you'll be able to see them. Wow. It's a big thing, and I want to make sure that you make time for that. You get all those announcements they're going to put probably next week so that you can mark those dates. There is power in prayer. Amen. I'm going to invite you to stand up on your feet with me right now as you come before him in prayer. In his name. What a word, what a word, what a word. Praise God. And if you have time, just go and go through the nuggets. She shared a lot here today. And you know, for me to be believing, it would have been very hard for me to believe that you are preaching for the first time, Les. She did a good job, didn't she? Yeah. Beautiful. Praise God. Keep on moving in that direction. You serve as an example. And you spoke well. It was clear delivery, and we thank God for that in Jesus' name. Amen. And in that, I want to appreciate, I know she's rushed to the bathroom. Aline did a very good job in your communion service. That was awesome. Thanks, David, for bringing her in Jesus' mighty name. I do want to pray for people. There are a lot of things that have been mentioned here, but I also want to pray for people, those that are saying, she spoke about the value of speaking in other tongues. You do not know how important that is.
It is.
In your own language, in your own way, life can be dreary. It can be very difficult to go through. But praying in the Spirit helps you. See, over time, the church has been taught a lot of erroneous teachings out there about the value of tongues. And as a result, oftentimes you end up throwing the what in the baby water. What did they say?
Baby.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's right. There's a baby in that water. And we want to make sure that you get the baby. Throw away the dead water, but get the baby there. There is value in speaking in tongues. And you and I, when we understand the power of that, the Lord is going to help us. Why don't you just ask us, even in the presence of the living God right now, if you know you are not filled with the Holy Spirit and you would like us to have that experience, you can come and see me at any time. I will help you and I will walk with you so that I can be filled with the Holy Spirit. But I would just ask us right now, as many of us that are filled with the Holy Spirit, let's just begin to pray. Let's feel and pervade the atmosphere, even in the Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ. Shall we pray? Lift up your voice to him. Bakatara Marianda Rabasia Duroboshianda Ramariando Bikatara Basanda Ramariando Kosataka Mayanda Renderibosanda Rabakayandu Roboshekete Teremoyanda Renderibosianda Rabakayanda Rabashiando Bakatarabos and Derebotatarayanda. Honor your name, Jesus. We glorify your name. We thank you, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name. Baka
We glorify your name. Akataraba Sandarabayanda. Shikaramandi Rebosandarabakaya Darabayanda. Riketeterebosatarabakashiyanda. Ondarabasiterebosikarabayanda. Ondarabasatarabakashiyanda. Bakatatarabayandarabayanda. Bakatatarabayandarabashiyanda. Bakatatarabayandarabasiyanda. Rubochiyanda. Ondarabasi derebeke shiketeke moyandarabayanda. Glorify your name, Jesus. I glorify your name. I give you praise and I glorify your name. In Jesus' mighty name. Father, we thank you. We glorify you. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. That's our prayer this day, Father, that God, even as you dismiss us, you dismiss us under this canopy. Bring back the burden. Bring back the understanding of prayer. Bring back, Lord God, the love for prayer. Bring it back in our lives, oh God. Bring it back in our generations, oh God. Oh, that will be men and women of prayer. Never mind people of affluence. Never mind people of eloquent speech. But oh, that will be men and women of prayer. Lord, bring it back in our time. Bring it back in our churches, oh God. Bring it back of our sons and our daughters, oh God. We give you honor, Father, and we glorify your name. You spoke clearly. You spoke in a very simple way. But Lord, it was profound. We thank you for Sister Leslie. Thank you for using her. That God Almighty could bring in this simplicity of how God you brought it to her. In Jesus' mighty name. All those who agree with me, shout and say amen. 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 Make a decision today that when you leave this place, if there is anything that you want to go back to, be a person of prayer. Amen. Journal things down. She spoke a lot here today. Just go journal certain things down before you give God your next prayer list. Thank him for the last. Amen. Thank him that you are breathing. Thank him that, Lord, I thank you that I'm not dead. Thank you that God, you have given me life. I thank you for the miracles that God is doing in our lives. We serve a miracle working God. And that's my prayer for you. You see, oftentimes we get carried away. We get carried away because we love to see the immediate, the quick results of what God is doing. One time they tried to cast out a demon. You know the story in Mark chapter 8. They were casting out a demon out of a small boy. And when they cast it out, then the demon would not budge. They tried to do it. They bound it. It did not go. They loosed it. It would not go. And Jesus said something. There are things in your life that will not move unless you pray and fast. And I want us to be encouraged today. May you become a person of prayer. Let there be a personal vow over your life in Jesus' mighty name.